Okay, we are now recording. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. You might recognize me as a new face here at the CICMH. My name is Chris Pankowicz, and this is literally my second day stepping into the role of knowledge and research lead here at the CICMH. So very excited to be a part of this first webinar and looking forward to connecting with everyone for future editions. I would like to welcome everyone to the webinar hosted by the Mental Health Commission of Canada. Following the recent launch of the standard, Sandra Coppert, who's the Director of Programs and Priorities at the MHCC, is here to provide an overview and field some questions from all of you. She's also being joined by Shannon Noonan, who is the Manager of Mental Health Strategies and Initiatives at Carleton University. Before I dive into letting them take it away, a few housekeeping notes. As participants, we have some settings in place, but also ask you to make sure that your cameras are turned off and your microphones muted during the presentation. If you are having any technical issues, please contact either Michelle Ng or myself via a private chat message, and we can try to help you out. Please utilize the Q&A function at the bottom of your screens if you do have any specific questions. We will try to answer as many of those as possible at the end of the webinar. Just to let everyone know, this presentation is being recorded and archived for later viewing. And after the session, an evaluation will be sent out via email. So we do encourage you all to please take a few moments to complete that. A brief land acknowledgement. We are all viewing and participating in this webinar on traditional territories of Indigenous peoples of Turtle Island. And we want to recognize that their contributions to this place and express our gratitude for our ability to come together and learn today. So without further ado, I would like to pass along the presentation to Sandra to take it away.
Thank you, Chris. And thank you, Maria, for inviting us to be a part of this session today. And great job, Chris. I think it's day two for you and you're doing fantastic. So we're thrilled to be here on this webinar. We have been engaging with some of you, for a while now, and some of you may be newer to this conversation. But as Chris mentioned, I am Sandra Coppert, a director at the Mental Health Commission. We're a nonprofit organization primarily funded through Health Canada in support of mental health across the country. And this session, we will be focusing on the newly released National Standard for Mental Health and Well-being for post-secondary students. And we're thrilled to have this important initiative that's 2 years in the making, really coming to life, and continuing to engage with all of you on this work, and also acknowledging that, you know, we are facing some different realities. I say some, for some it's quite significant. We know that that's certainly true within the post-secondary world. And so, we'd be remiss to talk about anything related to mental health, and certainly within the post-secondary world, without acknowledging current realities, which is what we've been busy doing while supporting the finalization of the standard and the release, is also continuing to understand current realities due to COVID and the pandemic for the post-secondary world, and how we can continue to support you folks through this in alignment with the standards. We do have some great resources, including a starter kit that is also available and that we will be featuring today as well, just to walk you folks through some of the early stages of what you can do in support of the standard as you're familiarizing yourself with this work. I'm also joined by a great team, and including Amy Fogarty, who will be presenting as well some of the key pieces of this work. And as Chris mentioned, we also have great guest feature with us from Carleton University, Shannon Noonan, who will be speaking to as well. So really, some of the focus areas will be looking at getting familiar, of course, with the standard. Some of you may already be more than others. So, understanding that there's different stages of engagement and, I guess, readiness as well to move forward with this work. So we'll be helping you to understand what that could look like for you, because it could be different for everyone, to help make the case for working with the standard, as well as finding a champion, making plans. So much of this is about planning. It's a journey, not a destination. And identifying key stakeholders to engage with. So some of those early stage pieces that if you aren't already looking at, hopefully we'll be inspired to do so moving forward. So we'll make the most of the time that we have with all of you today. And we do invite you to use the chat feature. We will be monitoring it, but just for the sake of time and for us to be as organized as possible, we mostly will save questions till the end in case something gets scanned and popped up as we go. We'll also be including any links and relevant information where we can. So please do use the chat feature. But just to get started, because like I said, everything is about this standard, we did want to do a quick poll with all of you, and who doesn't love an interactive feature? So Chris has got it ready to go. And the question is, do you plan to read the standard? So we're just asking you to read it. That will require you to access it too, of course. But just to get a sense of, you know, your timing, obviously now you consider yourself aware of the standard, and just getting a sense of when do you think that you might be starting to access it and take a look at that as well. So if you can just take a moment to answer the poll, and then we'll take a quick look at the results. And has that been enough time for everyone? Let's go to it. Okay. So about half have already downloaded it. That's great. And we know that as much as we're happy to have this a free and accessible resource for all of you, we know that it might be a bit challenging to access. So it's great to see that, you know, quite a few of you have and have access to it, or you know, are planning to do so in the near future, which is great. And anything that we can do to help facilitate that, we certainly will be looking to as well. And it's just also, as I pass things over to Amy Fogarty, manager leading this project with the team, is just to give some context to the standard, and I'll be passing it over to Amy, but it's just important to understand that this is a voluntary standard that is kind of like a set of guidelines or a framework, as we've been referring to it. It's non-prescriptive, and it's really about, while it is on that set of guidelines, you know, in a standard format, is meant to be used and customized as every institution sees fit, and knowing that every institution has their own set of unique challenges and needs and opportunities, and that the standard is flexible enough to recognize that, and that it truly is for any post-secondary institution, universities, colleges, polytechnics, and anything else that sort of falls within that category was taken into consideration with the development of that standard. So with that, I'm going to pass things over to my colleague to continue to educate us all on the standard.
Excellent. Thank you, Sandra. It's such a pleasure to be here today, just following a project milestone last week with, you know, making it publicly available. And I see a number of names here that are attending live and who are familiar with this project, but allow me some airtime to just talk about why a standard. And some of the stats on the screen are probably not new at all to many of you who are listening today, but it does really provide the context and the why as to, you know, when this project was announced in 2018, it really was in response to a clear and pressing need, which the latest National College Health Assessment data supports. So just a couple highlights, 60% of students saying at that time they felt, you know, more than average or tremendous stress in the past year, 90% saying they felt overwhelmed at some point, 40% reporting stressed and the effects of stress on their academic performance, and 16% having seriously considered suicide. So really, you know, this voluntary standard comes at a time that it can support several key outcomes, and I'll just point to those as, you know, potential greater awareness and reduced stigma around mental health, potentially creating healthier and safer learning environments, improved opportunities for student success, and better life and resiliency skills for students that they can use at work, at school, and in their daily lives. So following almost 2 years of engagement and dialogue, the standard is now available for download, and I'll just ask the team to pop into the chat the direct links for those of you who have not had a chance to actually download your own copy. You can click the links and do so, and of course, those are available as well if you navigate to the Commission's website. So next, I think one of the big reasons for this webinar is to really talk about a resource that the Commission had an opportunity to create over the past few months, and we're calling it a starter kit. And this resource is to support Canadian post-secondary institutions in their early steps of considering the standard. So this starter kit is sensitive to the current pandemic reality, and also offers helpful information on how institutions have been responding to the evolving needs of their student population. So I mentioned over the summer, we had an opportunity to interview institutions to contribute to the content of this kit. And I'll just name them right now and acknowledge their contributions, which was Red River College, Fanshawe College, Dalhousie University, Concordia University, the University of Calgary, and that last but not least, Carleton University is joining us today. So we encourage everyone to download their copy of the starter kit as well. That can be done through our webpage, and we can also share the links to the starter kit in English and in French for you to access. So what is the starter kit? It's an interactive PDF that we have the opportunity to update as appropriate, and it's really just this initial resource intended to support institutions who might be considering starting this work with the standard. It links to a variety of tools, templates, and resources, and I just want to highlight a few new tools that were developed because of what was shared in the interviews. And that includes, first and foremost, a quick summary of the standard. It also includes a customizable slide deck for potentially getting support and buy-in if applicable. There's also a graphic outlining stages of implementation to look for, as well as a helpful overview of what has changed in the first 6 months of the pandemic, I guess, since March at post-secondary institutions. So throughout the starter kit, we've also linked to the CSA community, which we encourage you to join and follow. We're calling that the core. And there you can find resources, including a compendium of supplementary resources developed by the technical committee, as well as other supportive tools and models. So the starter kit I mentioned presents a simple five-stage framework that starts with establishing a foundation and builds towards continuous improvement. So to help institutions get started, we really wanted to focus on a simple process with three key steps: first, next, and ongoing. So today we'll be focusing on the first step, which is really around establishing a foundation and that idea that a strong foundation starts with getting the right support to carry your initiative forward. The next phase is around assessing your current situation and planning. And the ongoing phase is around addressing opportunities, evaluating results and outcomes, and looking to continuously improve while celebrating successes along the way. So I just want to touch on getting buy-in. And as part of stage one, establishing your foundation, really the first step is to download the standard and think about what support and buy-in looks like at your institution. Building momentum and support are key steps in any implementation process. And here we want to focus on getting support from decision makers and those who will champion the standard at your institution. And that includes senior administrators, students, and even members of the broader community. Making the case for working with the standard is one of the suggested actions in stage one. And the start of this journey may require you to make the case in your institution to align your efforts with the standard. And this is why we've included a presentation template called Get Buy-In as part of the starter kit. So the starter kit links to a slide deck, and this is, you know, just a snapshot that you have on your screen right now to help you make the case. The slides include talking points to help secure the support of key stakeholders, including senior administrators and chief executives. And the deck is really built in a way that, you know, is generic, so your institution's content can be inserted to customize the deck with information relevant to your institution. It also includes speaking notes with additional information that you can adapt to your preferred voice and style. So the next slide really shows about the flow of the slide deck, keeping it simple, limiting the number of slides. So the presentation starts with identifying the issue of student mental health as a critical one, then delves into supports to improve outcomes and how this is relevant to your institution. This slide deck also includes information about how this new national standard came about and the reasons behind it, providing that information upfront. And with the conclusion is really why the support of your audience is needed. Sandra, do you want to highlight this quote, or shall I take the pleasure of doing so?
Go ahead.
So we were so pleased to see, and to incorporate as part of our public awareness activities last week, a supportive quote from Carleton University, specifically from Suzanne Blanchard, Vice President of Students and Enrollment, talking about how wonderful it is to see the initiatives and best practices that you know, have been implemented at Carleton over the years be captured within the National Standard of Canada for Mental Health and Well-being of Postsecondary Students. And it really highlighting here that more than ever, mental health and wellness need to be at the core of university life. Thanking everyone involved in the development of the national standard, of course, on our line today, Maria Pajdan, who is a technical committee member. So congratulations to Maria. As you know, it's really about a community working together across the country to enhance the mental health and well-being of students. So it's really a moment and a milestone, I think, to pause on this journey as to where we are today, and we're looking forward to seeing what comes next.
Great. And with that, we are pleased to have Shannon Noonan joining us. We are actually, I would say the commission is quite familiar with Carleton University, starting back with a similar, yet in some ways very different mental health standard for workplaces that was launched back in 2013. And with the launch of that standard, we also did then carry out a 3-year case study project with a variety of workplaces to understand implementation support and try to identify champions to help support others in their journey with implementing that workplace standard. So I guess as much as it was such a great and satisfying moment to have official support from Carleton, I guess in some ways it shouldn't have come as a surprise knowing their understanding and familiarity with the workplace standard to be able to more formally embrace this new standard as well. And so it's great to talk to you, Shannon, and thank you for joining us. And, you know, I think if we could just even start, you know, take a pause on this current standard and maybe just start the conversation looking back at the workplace standard and sort of where it became sort of at least the beginning of a relationship with the commission and Carleton and, you know, understanding, supporting mental health through strategies following a standard. So if we could kind of get into that first and really just if you could help kind of set the context for us about Carleton's journey with the workplace standard and just kind of what helped Carleton to sort of join that journey as well, and sort of where that has taken you.
Well, I think that thank you first of all for the introduction, and I mean Suzanne can speak to it a lot better than I can, and her quote is pretty all encompassing. But she's often one of the first advocates and folks on our campus to speak about mental health and to continue to push us further in that realm. So we're just very lucky to have supportive leadership in that way. And that's part of the bigger picture, which we'll speak to later, I guess. but the journey of the Healthy Workplace, we have an office at Carleton called Healthy Workplace. And I think the decision was kind of not even a decision. It was an absolute yes, we're going to take this on, with Healthy Workplace being around for about 10 years and has made a lot of progress at Carleton and has a lot of strong engagement from the community and from the leadership to continue to further the initiatives of Healthy Workplace. So when the standard came out, I think it was a bit of a no-brainer for taking that on and trying to, it's kind of a fun process. Let's see where we stand and where we are at with the standard. And from there, the process of doing the audit and taking on the standard, I'm not in the Healthy Workplace office. I do have a colleague who is the Healthy Workplace officer who took that on as a project. But now I'm sort of mirroring her shoes, if you will, with the mental health framework. So my colleague took that on with looking at the audit, and then from there, like I think it was kind of nicely hand in hand with a process through Excellence Canada, and we were able to get awards for Healthy Workplace. We hold the platinum standard for Healthy Workplace and the gold standard for mental health at work. And a lot of that comes from being able to like package this all together and identify where we are meeting needs and that are identified from the national standard. So it's all kind of like it goes hand in hand, and then your work pays off because you can really tell your story. And I think that's one of the best outcomes of doing an assessment like this is being able to actually do that bit of data storytelling and share what is going on campus and what all the positive things that you're doing to support your community members.
That's fantastic. And yeah, that became an interesting evolution, I think, with the workplace standard, is that there were, indication from those that were, embracing the workplace standard to be recognized, because there's so much great work happening, that as a way to have that recognized, became, I guess, then that Excellence Canada route, and that it did align, their criteria did align with the standard. So it'll be interesting to see, where that maybe surfaces with this new standard as well as a potential model in one way or another. But those are some early conversations already happening. It'll be interesting to explore. And then I guess sort of segueing from having that support and understanding for an existing standard, did that sort of, I guess, further contribute then, I guess, what you're saying to once you've heard more of this new standard?
Yeah, it certainly helped to reduce the intimidation factor, I guess you could say, with having seen Healthy Workplace already testing the waters and being a part of that process, really seeing the benefits that they reaped from going through that inventory and being able to assess where they were at. It's advantageous. Like there's no other way to describe it. So I think that that definitely, makes a further case, the fact that we've already done the workplace standard makes a further case for, of course, taking on the student standard.
Yeah, that's great. And I think that's such a good point to this too, as we'll hopefully help highlight as we have this discussion, is that with this standard, similar to the workplace standard, there is what it's called, because it's a standard, it has some standard language to it, including an audit tool. But really what that is a list of sort of the key components of the standard itself that you can use as a way to kind of do a gap analysis or really assess like where your institution is at. Because we know you're all doing some really great things, and that it shouldn't feel like you're starting from scratch, that it is about assessing where you're at in relation to the standard. So then based on that, how can you then make your plan to move forward? But before we get more into that, one area that we did highlight within this starter kit, which isn't a full-on implementation guide, or it doesn't account for all of the important key pieces of the standard, but again, just based on current COVID realities and input from stakeholders, we did select some key pieces to help institutions get started within the current context. And one of those that, regardless of a pandemic or not, is certainly looking at finding those champions. And we're doing that even at the commission, understanding who the champions are for this work. But then even within the institution, it's finding those champions that can understand and embrace the standard. Like I see it also as being the influencers. Like in the kit, we do talk about ideally having some with authority to make decisions and be able to allocate resources accordingly. But it can also just be those that have a voice at a table and can help to influence what's being discussed or considered within meeting agendas and those things. So I think it can be a variety of factors at play. And just interested to get your take on that, Shannon, and what do the champions sort of look like in Carleton?
Yeah, so I mentioned Suzanne already. She is our Vice President of Students and Enrollment. So her portfolio really looks after students and well-being of students. And that's why we are nestled under her. And she really is and has been an active champion for a number of years. So it's convenient that we already have her as a support. However, that comes from a beginning stage, like many years ago when our first mental health framework was done. So she initially had to start somewhere and signed on as a champion, sort of like made herself known. Now we know that she is one of our biggest proponents, but at that time there had to be someone who stepped up. And so for her, I think it's it's very important in her role to show that we do care and that we do care about students' well-being and that we're always trying to continuously improve. So yes, it does help to have her buy-in, because part of what she's looking after is our, she's chair of our student mental health advisory committee officially. And so that's a group of stakeholders where decisions are being made about the mental health framework on campus and initiatives. And any kind of things that are discussed with at that table are certainly going to be pushed or implemented. And she's often someone who's sought out for opinions on things. And, you know, there's a lot of media attention to her portfolio and a lot of, you know, a lot of kind of important aspects of running the university coming under her purview. So I think that that is part of the reason why she is such so well positioned, because she has a lot of influence for sure. So the of course it's very important to have someone who is influential and can make top down decisions and help you out. However, we also have, I would be remiss not to mention our president, Benoît Antoine Bacon, who is a person with lived experience with mental health, who shares his story constantly and tries to open up the conversation around mental health and supporting others and creating a supportive community and opening doors for those in recovery and pushing the messaging that the help is there and people do need and deserve help. And this is his, you know, his kind of mission as president or persona to make this culture a top-down experience as well. So to have someone like that who is very much an advocate and, you know, continuously pushing anything to do with mental health is going to be well-received and well-supported. So it's very good to have some people in different positions actually who are leading the charge and sort of saying yes to these opportunities, and they do see them as opportunities, not challenges and not checkbox things to complete. It is opportunities to continuously improve and to showcase what we're doing to help students.
Yeah, and that's where, you know, in some ways it's fortunate to feel maybe ahead of the game that way, because those are such key, I would say, you know, success factors when we're talking about the standard and so much of the, you know, standard and with, of course, with workplace as well is, you know, it's about culture and it's about perspective and leadership, not only support, but, you know, walking the talk is, of course, critical. And so, you know, I'm sure that there's other institutions that have that or can hopefully seek that out. And then others, it might be a bit more of a struggle. And that's where I think there is opportunity for, you know, support to come bottom up and top down. And can you speak a little bit more, though, about even sort of what that looks like, perhaps more at your level? Or where does this work with this new standard? Where do you see that kind of like fitting in even more operationally?
Yeah, I can go back to that, but I also just was thinking of something else because I noticed some engagement in the chat there and I wanted to speak to this point as well, because I think taking on the post-secondary standard, it actually absolutely does kind of echo the importance even more of taking on the workplace standard and actually having them both working in tandem, because we do need to be well in order to support our students. And especially now during COVID, you can see how much more important that is, that a lot of us are waning in our resilience right now. And we can empathize and understand where students are at even more so now than ever before. And I think that this is a shocking new reality for us to actually understand, you know, those who are maybe underserved and those who are unable to access support in an equal way to as others, that how important it is for us to align both of our standards. And I guess, yeah, I'm kind of on a tangent now, but I wanted to acknowledge that point that was in the chat there that was very insightful.
Yeah.
So your other question, sorry, again.
Yeah, just so I like from that leadership champion perspective, we agree that that's critical. And for some that might be, you know, more accessible than for others. And so just wondering also what that can look like, you know, perhaps more at a staff level or even just sort of operationally, where do you see that fitting in?
Yeah, you definitely need someone who has the space in their portfolio to work on this. It can't be an off the side of the desk project. It actually does need some resource allocation. So human resource, especially to work on this. And there are creative ways that you can try to partner with other folks on campuses like professors and try to get those involved in the community who may have a research interest or just a general want a engagement interest. And that it like having a, I guess I'm taking the healthy workplace as an example, having a healthy workplace office with only one permanent employee and doing all of the work that we have done is not the work of just one employee. It is the engagement from the hundreds of champions that we have. We actually have healthy workplace champions, and they are within the staff and faculty who sign on from every department all over campus. There's probably at least 150 or so of them. And they kind of work to further the mission of Healthy Workplace because they recognize that it can't be done by just one person. And so that is a really cool and effective model as well, to create these champions who are at the staff and faculty level to go out and further the work that is being done.
Yeah, and I think that's a great point. And sort of building on that is the idea of like, look where the interest is, like, because some, you know, might face some roadblocks and challenges, and just to get sort of creative with, you know, where the support is and build momentum in, you know, different ways, depending on, you know, what each institution looks like. And so that, you know, if there is sort of one roadblock that, you know, hopefully the resources that we're building and continue to understand needs can, you know, continue to develop and support to help folks on this call and others that, you know, maybe do need some more support as they're building their buy-in and interest. But as I mentioned earlier, and just moving on to the next point is, we often refer to this standard as like a journey as opposed to a destination. And similar to what you were already saying, Shannon, it shouldn't be treated as a checklist. And, you know, when we're talking about mental health and supporting it, it certainly is based in the standard on a model of continuous improvement, and that it is about assessing where you're at, making plans to address, you know, the different pieces and priorities, and they can't all happen at the same time and they can't happen overnight. And anything that does get put into place, it's, you know, making that sustainable and checking on it and reviewing it and improving on it. So that's where, you know, we often say, you know, to treat this in bite-sized pieces so that it can otherwise be overwhelming. And so I think it's, you know, great to assess where you're at and work with what you have, ensure that that's strong and sustainable, and then, you know, build it from there. And so I think all of that comes with strategy and planning. And we know that the pandemic has impacted time and resources perhaps more so than before, but we know for others it's also that opportunity to reassess, you know, plans and where they're at, and hopefully have something like the standard to refer to, you know, for plans moving forward. So why would you say that it's important to make plans and to have it be like a strategic approach?
Well, actually, when I was thinking about this point earlier, it's very timely because we actually just had a strategic plan launch at Carleton University. It's on September 30th. And I just couldn't help but reflect on the engagement in that plan. And when we had a virtual launch that was live, and there was, you know, it was really great production value on the video. And however, the live parts, there were actual chats happening and people asking questions back and forth to the president, which he was answering in live feed. And it was just a palpable energy that you could feel even from a distance, and the engagement in that launch and after the launch, and, you know, emails flying back and forth. on action items that maybe had been kind of put to the back burner for a couple months, and now all of a sudden people are rejuvenated and feeling this like sense of rejuvenation to look to the future, despite everything that's going on and everything that's happening around us, that I think we do need it. Like, I think that people do need something to grab onto and look forward to and have hope for the future. And, whether that is, adapting our plans currently to the current reality and for however long that might look, or looking ahead to when things do go back to somewhat normal, having some of those joys in person and restored in person or what have you, that might provide some needed inspiration right now for someone who is working at home and feeling like they're not making much of a difference. That I think that having those plans in place, and similarly with anything, like we've also just launched there's an action plan for equity, diversity, inclusion going on right now at Carleton, and there's constant consultations and people are being involved and consulted and very collaborative. And I think that those initiatives, they influence each other, first of all, and they do help to have folks feel that they are still connected. And I think what we need desperately is connection right now, despite the distance, and that they're part of something bigger. And, we're not just plugging away at our desks. And I'm making assumptions that most of us are home right now, but hats off to those if you are working on campus or having to go out of your home. But for many, it's a bit of an isolating time. So I guess that is a roundabout point of saying, there's huge value in looking forward to the future and forging ahead despite these difficulties that are happening. And just telling students that we are still interested in their well-being. And similarly to, they're in the standard starter document, you'll see the NCHA and surveys, and along with the new campus well-being survey that's also being recommended as a tool to use for measurement. And I think, sending out a tool like that to students really sends a message that, we're not actually putting it on the back burner until things are normal again. We actually still do care and about your well-being right now and what things are like. And yes, maybe the results may not be reflective of a normal year, but what is a normal year anymore? So yeah, that's kind of my point there.
Yeah, no, those are some excellent points. And I think that's where it's, even the starter kit is to further provide some guidance and suggestions and ideas. Again, there's no one right way to do this. And it's looking at what, each institution is already doing, but that there is a number of different ideas to explore, just even ensuring that, yeah, that student voice is understood, and that even if, not everything has a solution or an immediate solution, but I think, communication is so critical in acknowledging the struggles and challenges. We know just in general from our work with mental health is important for people to feel validated in their feelings and that they're not alone in them. And that, how we support mental health can look different for different people, be it in a pandemic or otherwise. And so I think that, there's also a lot of opportunity, as you've already been mentioning, to, have voices be heard and acknowledged, that there's a number of ways to, access information and data, so that even, if using, the audit tool or some other pieces to familiarize and plan with this standard, is to ensure that those are also informed decisions. And maybe that's the next step too, is how to, further engage students or look at different data options that are available, even through administrative data surveys and other sources, or, connect with others that could provide those insights. And that's another thing that we're so proud of with this being a national standard, is that it's a further way to leverage great work that is already happening across the board, and that it doesn't have to be a siloed approach, that so much already we're learning about great things that, you know, Carleton and so many other institutions are doing, in that, you know, as this being a national initiative, is that there is more opportunity, I think, to leverage great work that's happening out there, and that everyone can kind of learn from each other in that way. And there is a number of resources, and we'll soon be passing it back to Amy to talk about them a little bit more in just terms of what's already available in addition to this starter kit to support you folks in your journey. There's a number of resources that we've been collecting along the way, knowing that this isn't brand new to be supporting student mental health. So as we've been doing so much work to inform this standard, we have been collecting a number of great resources that already exist. And it compiled that into an online resource center that also includes some additional brand new resources that the technical committee for the standard have been developing as well. So again, it shouldn't never feel like you're starting from scratch, or that you don't have, you know, any supports to get going, or to, you know, help you make your plans. And we continue to support that moving forward, which is great. But just moving on, we also want to look at something that was highlighted within that starter kit. And again, this is just with stage one. It's not a full implementation guide, but just for those that maybe do have some limited resources and time, these are just some things to start, you know, start on your journey. And also just identifying those key stakeholders, which involve, you know, representation of stakeholder groups that impact the standard, including, of course, students. And similar to the development of the standard itself, there was so many variety of expertise and opinions and feedback that went into the standard, including the voice of the student, but as well as faculty and staff, and that you can't really have a conversation with one without the other. And then there's just so many in between when we talk about the service providers, and, you know, we can even refer to as frontline workers that we know and we've been hearing from that have been dealing with a lot and have extra, you know, pressures, I would say, at this point in time, but also that there are those silver linings of, you know, maybe more access to virtual care, and perhaps even more of an interest for some that prefer that. So it's great to also just see that, you know, through some challenging times, some innovative approaches are also surfacing, which are great. We also heard more anecdotally from another group that they're doing virtual pet therapy and some of those things, that it's not always like, okay, this means creating, you know, more, as much as there is that investment in time and resources into this, it's not a blanket statement for a need for more counseling services necessarily. It's knowing that there's such a variety of ways to support student mental health and really understanding that within your communities. But getting back to identifying stakeholders, just wondering if that's something else that you can speak to more, Shannon, in terms of your approach or kind of where you see things moving forward at Carleton.
So in terms of identifying further stakeholders or students?
I think, well, just knowing, and you've already touched on it, that it's not just students that we're talking about, but of course students are a critical part of this, but of course also faculty and others. And, you know, during this pandemic, perhaps that's even changed a bit more. Like, I think there might be more pressures on faculty. So, you know, this could be perceived as an additional, you know, responsibility on faculty as opposed to an opportunity. So we're just trying to understand different, I guess, perspectives on that and what you guys are factoring in at this time.
Yeah, I think that we take engagement where we can get it from, you know, we do have a short list, so to speak, of faculty members who are super engaged from each faculty, and we try to stay connected and stay attuned to their needs and what's going on. And in that way, we are often responding with additional kind of customized training or random resources that we might create for them based on the need. So for sure, I think having appointed folks that you can always lean on to ask and to consult with, without sort of also overburdening the same people all the time. So there's always, you know, if you're connecting with somebody that you're finding that you always connect with, then maybe just asking them, you know, who else should I connect with in your department, or who else should I reach out to that would be a great champion for this. And for students, I think it's the same kind of approach. It's not just going to the students who are in your office but going to where the students are actually at in a more broad scheme. So that might, for us, it's the student groups, such as the student unions or the clubs and societies that are all throughout campus, to try to engage key stakeholders from each of those who can actually further the information. So bringing questions out for feedback. We have a student mental health engagement committee that's open to the whole student body. So those folks also are, you know, it's open, so anyone can join it, and those folks are consulted on things such as, you know, if we're doing updates to the wellness website right now, so just sent out a feedback form for them, gaining their feedback in all different ways. Using social media as a tool right now is huge. So our health promotion team is doing polls to gather information. So they've shifted their approach to more of a assessment-based approach as well. And they're doing assessments all the time in their programming. So, you know, the poll that we took today in this webinar would be similar. But it's a those quick sound bites that you can get from social media. So you're not going to get a full-on survey from Instagram, but you might get some really good information from the following that you have. Does that kind of answer your question, or is that where you're going?
No, absolutely. We know there's a lot of just interested in perspective, because we know, again, it'll look different for everyone. So it's just great to get a sense of, we know there's a lot of factors at play. And so, you know, just everything that you're considering at this time. So I think that's really great. And what we're going to do with the time we have left is, first, I'm going to ask you if you have anything else to share before I turn it back to Amy, just to talk a bit more about some of the key resources and benefits, and then have a formal kind of Q&A time left. But just for you, Shannon, is there anything else that you'd like to share at this point from what we've been discussing?
I think it's just the idea that the standard, like, that you have to be ready to take on the standard. And I think it's more of a continuous improvement process, and that you don't have to actually be assuming you're going to check all the boxes in order to take it on. It's something that, you know, it's not, no one's going to defund your university if you don't hit the standard. But it's a value driven process, that if you believe in it, and that you would identify with it and say that your campus does want to meet the standard, that go for it and take it on, and absolutely reach out for help if there's anybody that needs some assistance out there, or some more brainstorming, or, you know, you can feel free to consult with us anytime. And I'm sure that CICMH and Mental Health Commission would say the same.
Wonderful. Well, that's great. So don't leave just yet, because we will be having a Q&A, but I just want to quickly thank you for the time joining us today, and for all the great work that you're leading and your colleagues are leading at Carleton. So thank you for that. We'll pass it over to Amy and continue the conversation.
Definitely. Thank you, Sandra. So I think just before we close up the portion before we get to Q&A, is we just wanted to highlight, you know, the importance of supporting, you know, these efforts. And I think back to some of the early aspirations around the standard was really to support, you know, collaboration on a national level. And so to support that, there's definitely access to the Center of Outreach, Resources, and Engagement, which I mentioned earlier, we refer to as the CORE, which is available through CSA's community. And it's really to, you know, an online collaborative community where post-secondary institutions can share resources and get access to some models and tools and best practices to support their work and aligning with the standard. Also wanted to touch on a couple other things that are coming soon. So we've also been supporting the development of a self-assessment tool. And of course, we can never do this work alone. So it's been supported by a number of post-secondary institutions over the last few months. And we've been working with the Social Research and Demonstration Corporation. On this tool, it's really intended for institutions to help them benchmark where they're currently at in relation to meeting the clauses within the standard, and to assist them in identifying opportunities as part of this continuous improvement process. And it's really going to be building on the sample internal audit tool that is within the standard. And last but not least, another bit that is coming soon is a series of workshops and virtual sessions to further support the standard, post-secondary institutions who might be eyeing it and thinking about working with the standard. And so I think I'll pause there. I did notice a number of comments within the chat that I think we might have an opportunity to get to. But before I do so, just want to highlight that there is an email address. If you'd like to connect with the commission, we invite you to do so. We have an email address that is studentstandard@mentalhealthcommission.ca. So if you're looking for information or if you need access to resources, of course, you can navigate to it via our webpage, or you can drop us an email if you'd like to join our communications. We can include you in our regular updates about specifically about the standard. Just looking at some of the comments, thank you, Tammy, for a number of the comments within the chat. I was definitely reading them and trying to acknowledge them as we went along, definitely around the need for human connection. And you were mentioning about the importance of continued contact, even over the summer months, just because programs or courses have ended, just continuing that regular contact because of the challenges around isolation and COVID and just presenting challenges on mental health. So I definitely acknowledge that comment. So I think Katie's put the student standard email address in our chat box. So I encourage you to reach out to us if you have any questions or if you'd like to join our communications.
If you don't mind, I can just also remind everyone, if there are questions, you could either post them via the Q&A section, or if you put your hand up using the functionality within the Zoom meeting, we can hover over and you give you access to talk on your mic.
There's a question about athletic department engagements. I guess I can speak to that, is that we have stakeholders on our Student Mental Health Advisory Committee who are from that department. So they are always in the loop and involved, if that answers the question, involved in the conversation. And I don't know if you're talking specifically regarding like varsity athletes or just the athletics as a whole, like athletics building, where students access athletic facilities.
Maybe Stephen, if you're still online, if you could elaborate. But it was looking at buy-in. So maybe it's just, I'm not an expert in the post-secondary world, but maybe just, I guess, a part of potential strategies could be looking at, different departments and groups and how, the standard can support that in different ways. So maybe, at Carleton, you're not there yet in terms of, looking at particular departments.
It says he's talking about how competition impacts mental health. I think that that's more of a, I can't really speak to like that specific issue and how competition impacts mental health, although we do have sports psychologists who work with our athletes, and honestly our athletes are some of the best supported people on campus. They have psychologists for each team that can be accessed 24/7 a lot of the times. They have text access to their coach or their team psychologist. So they do know, in my experience working with athletes at Carleton, is that they do know their resources and they are super well supported. I can't speak to how standardized that is across the country for other institutions, but it's certainly an area of interest to be explored and to be thought of during implementation of the standard.
Okay, No, that's great. And I think that's what part of this exercise will be too, and something that even when we were doing our engagement leading up to first a public review and then release was doing as much sort of stakeholder mapping as we could. And, you know, when you look at students and student groups and student needs, it's quite a range. So even when we talk very broadly about, you know, post-secondary students, it's we know that, again, when we're supporting mental health, like there are so many unique needs and challenges, and that can vary based on universities and colleges where they may be located, and just, you know, the student compromise as well. And so that's something else that we're looking to further explore, is where there might be gaps, you know, for specific student groups and communities within kind of what the more general supports can offer.
Definitely. And I think I just wanted to add on there another plug to you know, access our starter kit that is available on a complimentary basis for download, because there are some interesting insights in there that I picked up that are specific to the pandemic. One touches on online platforms requiring new approaches. And of course, you know, these meeting platforms online are essential to the continuity of classes, but then it does present a challenge on maintaining strong, trusting connections, you know, through a screen, which, you know, many months into this pandemic may be a factor. And I think I was picking up on perhaps, you know, that message through connecting through athletic departments, where there might be those connections there, as it sounds like they, you know, those students could be well supported, and that could be an avenue to reach them beyond, you know, the screen.
And this is great. This is only the beginning for us in terms of this conversation. I don't know if we'll have time to get to, there was a question about student mental health advisory committee. It does sound like having some sort of advisory committee, you know, could be an important step with aligning with the standard. We know that, you know, advisory committees and working groups within supporting the workplace standard have been quite effective, and often can be these joint committees, knowing that when we, I guess a broader point to this too, is that when we're talking about health, and nobody questions that we do so much, you know, to prevent and address, you know, physical health conditions on and off campus, is that we just wanna also make sure that we're broadening that conversation to include mental health when we're talking about the health and well-being of the students and faculty. So I think that these are some great points, and even these questions help to drive us in terms of, you know, more supports and dialogues that we can be having on this topic.
I just provided the purpose to our committee as well in the answers to that chat, but so that Stephen can have a look over that. But also just generally, like to answer the question about elaborating on what that is that it's a group of campus stakeholders all from different departments, and you try to make sure that we have representation from all different areas, including every faculty and office on campus. So an office, every office that kind of represents different student needs. And then from there, the purpose, obviously the committee does certain work to further the mental health framework, but also you can break out into other working groups or implementation committees to actually work on specific projects that need a little bit more of a working hands on deck type of thing, versus the larger advisory committee is really more just there to provide consultation, input, feedback for larger scale updates. And then if there's a specific project that needs to be worked on, then we branch out into smaller groups.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Thanks everyone for participating. We see that time is quickly running out. So hopefully, you know, this is a start to more conversation and you know, really trying to dive into this standard. You'll find information on our website, links to all of the resources, information we've been discussing, as well as of course our student standard email that we will monitor it, we promise. If you have any further questions or to make any connections, but do keep us posted too. We can add you to any of our distribution lists, so that as more information or resources pop up, that we can share that with you, as well as, you know, continue this conversation Maria and Chris and all of you, you know, as we continue to support this standard. But a big thank you to you, Shannon, and Carleton University for your support on this, and looking to, you know, understand more of your journey as we move forward. Thanks to the team at the Commission for all their work to get this work released and continue to socialize it. And again, a big thank you to you, Maria and Chris.
Thank you very much. And Sandra, there was one other question people had asked about the recording. The recording will be up on campusmentalhealth.ca. And we did share this email in the chat box. And the only other question was the PowerPoint deck. Is that something that you're able to share with us? And then we'll make sure all of the participants receive a copy.
Sure, we'll coordinate with you on that. That's great. Thank you for the interest, and know that there is a lot of resources to support you, and otherwise do reach out to us. Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, everyone. A kind reminder as well, if anyone hasn't signed up for our upcoming conference on November 3rd, you can still register at campusmentalhealth.ca. And we would love to have you there. Thank you very much, everyone. Have a good night.